Friends, it's a great pleasure to have amidst us Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramanian as our guest speaker this evening. On behalf of our international president, Mr. Tim Boyd, on behalf of you all, and on my own behalf, I extend a very warm and hearty welcome to Justice V. Ramakrishna. As we all know, that for the last several decades, one session during the International Convention is devoted to the memory of Dr. Annie Besant and eminent speakers and scholars from different walks of life have been invited to deliver Besant Memorial Lecture. And this evening, we have amongst us a renowned, eminent speaker, Honorable Justice V. Ramakrishnan. Born on 30th June 1958 at Mannargudi in erstwhile Tanjavur district, he completed his schooling in Hindu High School, Triplicane. After graduating in chemistry from Ramakrishna Mission Vivekananda College, he studied law and got enrolled as an advocate in the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry in February 1983. After a brief stint as a junior in the office of senior advocates, he set up independent practice in 1987. And on 31st July 2006, he was elevated as judge of the Madras High Court. In the past nearly 10 years of his judgeship, he has rendered several landmark judgments, some of which were the first of their kind in India. The decision rendered in the case filed by Bharat Matrimony against Google was the first of its kind in India on the question of infringement of trademark by an internet search engine. His decision in Rashtri Sugar versus Axis Bank was the first decision in India on the validity of the contract of derivatives, with a typical contract that was baffling even to professionals in the banking industry. His judgment in Colgate-Palmolive versus Anchor Toothpaste set a new trend on the question of disparaging advertisements, otherwise known as advertisement wars, between competing industries engaged in the manufacture and sale of consumer products. While his judgment in Vandana versus Srikanth was the first decision under the Domestic Violence Act to give a new dimension to the concept of shared household, his decision in Akash versus Vanita Vijay Kumar introduced for the first time in India the concept of shared parenting in child custody disputes. Justice V. Ramasubramanian is known for his different style of writing judgments with humorous punches. The Madurai edition of the Hindu carried an article in October 2010 about his style of writing under the caption of "The Art of Writing Judgments." Again, the same National Daily carried another report under the caption "All in a Lighter Vein" in April 2014, hailing him as one who uses humor as to ease tension in the court hall. A prolific speaker both in Tamil and English, his 50 articles are now compiled and is soon to come out in the form of book. Now, with these words, I will request Honorable Justice V. Ramasubramanian to begin his talk on passion, dispassion, and compassion.
Dear Theosophists, ladies and gentlemen, I am always accustomed to my name being wrongly pronounced on the dais. And today was no exception. Therefore, I take pleasure introducing myself as Ramasubramanian. The person who made announcement at the beginning gave you a caution that if your mobile phones ring, you may have to pay a donation of rupees 500 to the flood relief fund. But out of enthusiasm for increasing the donations to the flood relief fund, I hope you would, all of you would not switch on the mobile phone. There is an inherent danger in such an advertisement, such an announcement. All the caller tunes that we have in our mobiles constitute an infringement of the copyright of someone else. Therefore, the amount of rupees 500 that you may be called upon to pay, part of it may have to go to the originator of the person who holds the copyright for the tune. Therefore, I do not know how much of it will actually go to the flood relief fund. Anyway, you can reserve your enthusiasm to contribute to the flood relief fund in the other lectures, and I should not become the victim. Dear friends, I feel both proud as well as humbled by the invitation extended to me to deliver the Besant lecture as part of the 140th International Convention of this great society. I am proud since I perhaps happen to be the first, may not be the last, sitting judge of the Madras High Court in independent India to have ever been invited to deliver the Besant lecture. Though the Theosophical Society had gone to the High Court never came to the Theosophical Society, except perhaps for morning walk, because many of the judges of our High Court have their morning walks only in the Theosophical Society, and even occasionally we do not stumble upon the library there. I am aware that great lawyers like Sir C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer, Nani Palkhivala, Soli Swarabji, Fali Nariman, and Ashok Desai, as well as great judges like Justices Venkatachalaya, Jeevan Reddy, Dharmadhikari, and J.S. Verma, have delivered the Besant lectures in the past, but no judge of the Madras High Court, for whatever reason, appeared to have been ever involved. appear to have been ever invited to deliver the Besant lecture, at least from 1950 till date. This is despite the fact that it was Sir S. Subramanian Iyer, a judge of the Madras High Court, who was instrumental in incorporating the Theosophical Society in 1905, and of which he became the vice president in 1907. Justice Sir S. Subramanian Iyer's contribution was unique, since he served the society as its lawyer before he went on to become a judge. At the peak of his judicial career as the acting Chief Justice of the Madras High Court, he relinquished office, citing ill health. Apart from serving the Theosophical Society as a lawyer, he also served the society by volunteering to be a witness in the famous child custody case in a court which he presided over for more than 12 years. Towards the last days, Sir S. Subramanian Iyer lived the life of a saint with no more possessions than a pair of clothes and a danda in his hand. Therefore, I feel proud to be able to stand before you to share a few thoughts on this topic. I also feel humbled for a reason. We in this part of the world believe that number 108 is mystical, number 108. Therefore, in a society of which Justice Subramanian Iyer was the Vice President in 1907, I, his namesake, Justice Ramasubramanian, has come to deliver the Besant lecture exactly after 108 years. This is why I feel proud. The reason why I feel humbled is that this is the soil in which the seeds of great philosophical thoughts of the 20th century were sown. This is the land where destiny demonstrated that its ways are inscrutable. When the Theosophical Society anointed Jiddu Krishnamurti as a world teacher in the Order of the Star in the East, he denounced the claim that he was a messiah. People thought Annie Besant's predictions about Jiddu Krishnamurti being a messiah went wrong. But J. Krishnamurti later turned out to be one of the most celebrated philosophers of the 20th century, proving Annie Besant right and his own disclaimer wrong. Therefore, I feel humbled to have been invited to deliver this Besant lecture. I do not know how you chose the topic compassion and universal responsibility as the central theme for this 140th International Convention. The recent monsoon and the floods that devastated Chennai about 3 weeks ago brought to the fore the compassionate face of Chennai and the universal responsibility that youngsters assume to themselves to save the city. Soon as flood water drained, we realized that compassion had not completely drained out of the hearts of the citizens of Chennai. Therefore, I feel that the central theme of this convention was perhaps dictated from above by the same forces that dictated many things to Madame Blavatsky and Leadbeater. Otherwise, the choice of the theme could not have happened by mere coincidence. There is also another coincidence. On May 13th, 2015, Pope Francis marked the second anniversary of his election by declaring the year 2016 as a special jubilee year, the Holy Year of Mercy. A jubilee year, rooted in the Old Testament, is a special year called by the Father for remission of sins and to receive blessings and universal pardon. Since the year 1300, the Church has declared jubilee years every 25 or 50 years. The jubilee year traditionally starts with the opening of the holy door of the St. Peter's Basilica, followed by the opening of the holy doors of the other three major basilicas in Rome, namely St. Mary Major, St. Paul's Outside the Walls, and St. John Lateran, as well as the holy doors of other basilicas around the world. The opening of the doors signifies God opening a new pathway to salvation, mercy, and grace. Therefore, the central theme you have chosen for this international convention appears to be the most appropriate. The topic that I have chosen for this lecture is passion, dispassion, and compassion. While passion and compassion are attributes of the manas, mind, dispassion is an attribute of buddhi, the intellect. But fortunately or unfortunately, it is the mind that either binds or liberates. This is why the Upanishads declared Manayeva Manushyanam Karanam Bandhamokshaye. Mind is the root cause for both bondage as well as salvation. When Buddhi, the intellect, reigns supreme, having absolute control over the mind, an ordinary emotion that takes the form of passion gains Viswarupam to become compassion. In other words, it is dispassion, the Sanskrit equivalent of which is Vairagya, that transforms passion into compassion. This is in essence the connecting thread between passion, dispassion and compassion, and this is why I have chosen this topic to share a few of my thoughts with you. In a way, it can be stated that the two great epics, namely Ramayana and Mahabharata, were composed by sages who were known for their vairagya or dispassion. But they composed these epics in moments when they were overwhelmed by passion at the sufferings of other creatures, and when such passion transcended the normal emotional upheaval into one of compassion. Most of you may be aware of the story as to how Valmiki composed the Ramayana. When Valmiki and his disciple Bharadwaja arrived at the Tamasa Tirtham on the banks of the river Ganges, both of them saw a pair of Krauncha birds making love. Suddenly, a hunter appeared from nowhere and shot down the male. The great sage Valmiki, who had already renounced the world and who was fully conscious of the inevitable cycle of birth and death that every creature has to go through in this world, was suddenly overwhelmed by sorrow upon seeing the plight of the female bird. Overcome by passion, Valmiki said, Ma nishada pratishtam tvam agamaha saswati samaha yat krauncha mitunat yekam avadi kama mohitam. Scholars attribute three different types of meaning to this utterance of Valmiki. The literal meaning of this verse is as follows. O ill-fated hunter, you have killed a male bird when it was in lustful compassion with its female counterpart. Therefore, you may not attain an immortal life on earth. After making this utterance, sage Valmiki regained his compose and wondered as to how he could have been overcome by passion. Then he thought, Sokartena asya sagunehe kimitam vyahrutam maya. He understood that these words were uttered by him out of sorrow. But immediately he also realized that this particular utterance was poetic, composed in a particular meter, and was also capable of giving different meanings, exactly the opposite meaning. Therefore, Valmiki told his disciple, Sokartasya pravrto me sloko bhavatu na anyatha. Let this utterance be treated not as a curse but as a verse. This is what Valmiki declared, and that is how the great epic Ramayana was born. A sage who was known for his dispassionate approach towards things was overcome by passion which transcended into compassion, and we had a great epic on hand. Similarly, the Mahabharata, composed by Krishna Dvaipayana Vyasa, was narrated by his student Vaishampayana immediately after a huge snake sacrifice, Sarpayagam, organized by Janamejaya, the son of Parikshit. The passion for revenge that Janamejaya had to be neutralized by a very young lad by name Astika. That Astika was a small boy who was born to parents who carried the very same name, Jaratkaro and Jaratkaro. Interestingly, Vedavyasa did not attain fulfillment even after codifying the Vedas into four, and even after composing what we now call as the fifth Veda, Bharata Panchamo Vedaha. Mahabharatam is called the fifth Veda. He was not very happy with himself after all these attainments, after all these achievements. Therefore, Vyasa is said to have reached the banks of the river Saraswati in a perturbed state of mind. Do not think that we people who live in this mundane world alone have perturbed states of mind. Even sages, saints, seers who have renounced everything in the world also have perturbed states of mind at times. He said, Evam pravrittasya sada bhutanam shreyasi dvijaha sarvatmakena apiyada naptushyatu hridayam dataha nati prasidat hridayaha sarasvatyas tate suchau vitarkayan vivikthasya idam cha uvacha dharmavithu. The meaning is, O twice born, although Vyasa engaged himself in working for the welfare of the people, still his mind was not satisfied. Therefore, dissatisfied at heart, Vedavyasa began to reflect on the banks of the river Saraswati. Then what happened? Tatapi padame daihya hyatma cha ivatmana vibuhu asampanna ivabhati brahmavarchasya sattamaha. Vyasa said to himself, though I am fully equipped with everything that is prescribed by the Vedas, I feel incomplete and dissatisfied. It is out of this emotion that Srimad Bhagavatam was born. Therefore, even those who have renounced the world and have attained a state of vairagya or dispassion, or at times moved by passion, which assumes universal character, thereby becoming compassion. Therefore, I consider passion, dispassion and compassion to constitute the three legs of a tripod on which our lives are actually mounted. The words dispassion and compassion have as their root the word passion. Though the words dispassion and compassion convey emotions of the opposite nature, the English word passion had its origin in the Latin word passio, whose literal meaning is suffer. This is why in Christian theology, the word is used to indicate crucifixion, pain, suffering, or agony of Jesus Christ. In religion, your passion is always measured by the amount of pain or suffering that you are capable of taking upon yourself. Take the case of Abraham from the Old Testament. The Lord himself declared Abraham to be a prophet. But Abraham was ordained by the Lord to sacrifice his own son Isaac. According to the Old Testament, Isaac was born to Abraham when he was 100 years of age through his wife Sarah, who was also very old. Abraham's act is celebrated by many as holy from the theological point of view, though it meant pain and suffering from our mundane point of view. But in the modern world, the word passion does not denote pain and suffering alone. It is actually defined as an intense desire for something or a very powerful feeling. Robert Valeron, a professor of psychology at the University of Quebec, Montreal, did extensive research on passion and proposed a dualistic model of passion for activities. His research showed that a large percentage of people have passion for a variety of activities. He classified such passion into two types, namely harmonious passion and obsessive passion. Harmonious passion is one where the person controls his activity. Obsessive passion is one where the favorite activity controls the person. Therefore, whether you have harmonious passion or obsessive passion depends upon whether you have control over your favored activity or that favored activity has control over yourself. For instance, if I am passionate about playing tennis and devote an hour in the morning for playing it, it is a harmonious passion. But once I get addicted to it and I cannot resist the temptation to play on and on, unmindful of my regular work schedule, then it becomes an obsessive passion. What modern psychology has categorized as harmonious passion and obsessive passion is not something new to the world of religion and spirituality. We know that passion is born out of desire and it leads to attachment. When someone questioned a Guruji as to whether it is good to have attachment or not, the Guruji narrated a small parable. He said, once upon a time, Mullah Nasruddin was on a horse. The horse went round the same place again and again. When people asked Mullah as to where he was going, Mullah replied, "Ask the horse," because he did not know where it was going. Great teachers say that our desires should be like horses. You must be in a position to mount the horse when you want and dismount it whenever you don't want. Swami Ramakrishna Paramahamsa gave a wonderful narrative to explain this. While standing at the banks of a river, a person saw a black woolen blanket floating in the water. The man jumped into the water, caught hold of the wooden blanket. When he attempted to swim to the banks, he felt that the wooden blanket was pulling him in the opposite direction. Terrified by this, the man attempted to discard the woolen blanket, free himself from the woolen blanket. But then he realized that though he was not holding the blanket was actually holding him. A closer look revealed that what he was holding on to was not actually a black woolen blanket, but was actually a bear. Paramahamsa says that to begin with, you jump into the water of samsara and catch hold of the blankets of desire. Eventually, you do not possess them, but you are possessed by them. When you are in control of your desires, with an ability to discard them as and when you please, you are said to have harmonious passion. But when desires take control of you, you suffer from obsessive passion. Interestingly, the word passion is synonymous with the word raga, with the word rage. The Sanskrit equivalent of the word passion is raga. Therefore, what is raga, R-A-G-A in Sanskrit, is perhaps what is R-A-G-E in English. In other words, both English and Sanskrit appear to have similar words to describe the emotion of passion. Passion, as I told you earlier, is born out of desire that leads to attachment. But the state of desirelessness or non-attachment, which is known as dispassion on Vairagya, all the religions of the world accept the fact that desire leads to attachment and attachment leads to sorrow. The great Tamil poet Thiruvalluvar said, "Yadanin yadanin ningiyan nodal adanin adanin ila." It means that once your attachment to an object is removed, the pain and suffering that is likely to arise out of that object is also removed once and for all. Suppose I have a great attachment to a newly bought BMW car. I go and park it in a place. On the first day of my taking it out, I see a scratch on the body of the car. I get pain and suffering. This pain and suffering is a direct result of my attachment to that car. Suppose you take your friend's car and you see some scratches. Do you really suffer the way you would suffer if it were your own car? The reason is that this sorrow arises, the pain, suffering and sorrow arises out of your attachment to that object. That is what the Thiruvalluvar said in his couplet. Therefore, Oriental religions advocate Vairagya or detachment as the panacea for the ills of sorrow. But the difficulty with Vairagya is that detachment or non-attachment is a disincentive to action or karma. Interestingly, the word kama in Sanskrit, kama means desire. The word kama is only one letter short of the word karma. The letter R probably stands for raga, which induces all human beings to achieve their kama through karma. In order to clear the doubt about the relationship between action and punishment, attachment, the Bhagavad Gita advocated a love for action but a detachment towards the fruits of action by proclaiming karmanye vadhikaraste ma paleshu kadachana. If you carefully look at the background from which the Bhagavad Gita emerged, you may see that Arjuna, the greatest archer of all times, who had fought many a battle before Kurukshetra and who never hesitated to kill fellow human beings on the battlefield, suffered from delusion in a state of mind called Vishada Yoga. This was actually born out of his attachment to his own kith and kin. Since the enemy army comprised of his cousins, teachers, granduncles, maternal uncles and nephews, he was overcome by confusion. But if the enemy army had comprised of non-relatives, would he have had the very same kind of delusion, vishadam, that he actually had? Then the question is, how did Arjuna, a great warrior, suddenly became a non-violent mendicant? After all, Emperor Ashoka faced the very same dilemma at the battlefield. But Ashoka's predicament was not born out of passion or attachment, it was born out of compassion that eventually led to Vairagya or dispassion. In the compilation of his famous lectures on the Bhagavad Gita, the celebrated Acharya Vinoba Bhave gave a very interesting parable to explain this Vishada Yogam. He said, once upon a time there was a judge. That judge was known for pronouncing a lot of death sentences. He had pronounced hundreds of death sentences upon culprits during the course of his usual judgments. People thought that he was wooden-hearted, and but the judge thought that he was a typical karma yogi who was absolutely discharging his duties without any kind of passion. He was dispassionately discharging his duties. That was what he thought about himself. One day, the police brought into his court a culprit. Unfortunately, the culprit happened to be the judge's own son. Immediately, the judge began asking questions. What is the purpose of this capital punishment? Would it really serve any purpose? What are we trying to achieve by imposing death penalty on somebody? Should we not have compassion? These are questions that the judge started asking to himself. Then Acharya Vinoba Bhave says, this is Judge Vishada Yoga. It became pretty clear that what prevented the judge from pronouncing death penalty was not his sudden transformation to the path of Ahimsa, but his attachment to his own son. The case of the judge was exactly similar to that of Arjuna. Thus, Passion born out of desire leads to attachment. Attachment leads to confusion and engulfs one in sorrow. This is why we have advocated Vairagya. Hindu Shastras speak about two types of Vairagyas. The first is called Prasava Vairagya. The second is Smasana Vairagya. The Prasava Vairagya is one which is actually a state of mind of a lady when she undergoes labor pain. At that state, she thinks that she will never even allow her husband to come anywhere near her. But the moment a child is born, that Prasava Vairagya disappears along with the labor pain, and they have the next child within a couple of months. The second type of Vairagya is the Smasana Vairagya that one develops when one goes to the crematorium or the burial ground to see off a near and dear. We had a great Siddha called Thirumoolar. Thirumoolar has sung a composition running to about 3000 verses. In one of his famous couplets, Thirumoolar said, "What happens immediately after death? ஊரலாம் கூடி ஒலிக்க அழுதிட்டு பேரையும் நீக்கி பிணம் என்று பேரிட்டு சூரையன் காட்டிடை கொண்டு போய் சுட்டிட்டு நீரினில் மூழ்கி நினைப்பொழிந்தார்களே." The meaning is, the moment the life goes out of the body, friends and relatives assemble and wail over the body. The moment life goes out of the body, the name with which the dead person was called affectionately also goes. You do not address the body as Mr. or Mrs. or Miss so-and-so anymore after a person is dead. You just say the body will be taken in another 1 hour or 2 hours. Therefore, the name goes. It is taken to the crematorium, burnt to ashes, and people who accompanied take a bath and forget sooner or later the person, his memories, and also the Vairagya that he gained temporarily at that moment. That is what is called Smasana Vairagya. Therefore, our scriptures advocate Vairagya as a tool to overcome sorrow. But the difficulty with detachment is that it serves as a disincentive to work, as I have told you earlier. Without desire and without attachment, there is neither a passion nor motivation to work. It is this dilemma that pushes people to both extremes. Since desire and attachment act as the prime mover for action, and also since action is inevitable to sustain the world, the Oriental religions of the world advocated a desire of a different nature and a passion of different dimension. Passion of a different dimension, different force, different nature, and different type is what we actually call as compassion. The story of creation and the answer to the questions, how did the world come into existence? Where did it come from? Can be found in a Vedic hymn, the English translation of which, as presented by Swami Vivekananda in the World Parliament of Religion, goes as follows. I quote, "Then there was neither aught nor naught, nor air nor sky nor anything. What covered all? Where rested all? Then death was not, nor deathlessness, nor change to night and day. Now first arose desire, the primal seed of mind. Sages, searching in their heart by wisdom, found the bond between existence and non-existence." I unquote. This is how Swami Vivekananda translated this great Vedic hymn into English. Therefore, it is clear from the Vedas, which are considered to be the treasure house of knowledge, that universe came into existence from out of a cosmic desire. This desire of cosmic consciousness is completely different from the desire that you and I possess. It is this desire which actually gets transformed into passion, into compassion. That takes us to the next question as to what is compassion. Is it simply a sense of sympathy or caring for the person suffering? Is it simply a warmth of the heart towards the person before you, or a sharp clarity of recognition of their needs and pain? No, it is not. Compassion is a sustained and practical determination to do whatever is possible and necessary to help alleviate the sufferings of others. In Shanti Parva, the 12th canto of the Mahabharata, Yudhishthira asks Bhishma to tell him by what condition of mind could one kill his grief when one loses his riches, his wife, his son, or his father. Bhishma narrates the conversation that took place between a king by name Senajit and a man of wisdom who visited the court of the king Senajit. Senajit was grief-stricken at that time on account of the death of his dear son. The man of wisdom asked Senajit, "Why are you stupefied? You are yourself an object of grief, and why do you grieve for others? A few days hence, others will grieve for you, and in their turn, they will be grieved for by others," that man of wisdom told Senajit. Upon hearing these words, King Senajit asks the following question: "What is that intelligence? What that penance, O learned man? What that concentration of mind? What that knowledge? And what that learning by gaining which you do not give way to grief?" The king asks. Then the person of wisdom replies as follows. Look at it carefully. He says, "Grief is the child of the disease created by desire. Happiness again comes when the disease of desire is cured. From joy originates sorrow, and the sorrow comes again and again. Sorrow comes after joy, and the joy after sorrow. The joys and sorrows of human beings are revolving on a wheel. Friends are not the root of one's happiness. Enemies are not the root of one's misery. Wisdom cannot bring on wealth. Wealth cannot give happiness. Intelligence cannot give wealth. Nor is stupidity the cause of poverty. Only a wise man and none else understands the order of the world. If objects of desire are renounced, they become sources of happiness. The man who follows objects of desire is ruined in that pursuit. When a person withdraws all desires like a tortoise, withdrawing all its limbs, then its soul, which is self-luminous, can see itself. Renouncing both truth and falsehood, grief and joy, fear and courage, the agreeable and the disagreeable, you may acquire equanimity of the soul." This is the reply given by the person of wisdom to the king Senajit. But even a man of wisdom cannot get rid of passion. In Buddhism, Avalokiteshvara is called the Buddha of compassion. They have created a god. I should not say God, they have created a Buddha of compassion, who is called Avalokiteshvara. He is often represented in Tibetan iconography as having 1,000 eyes that see the pain in all corners of the universe to extend his help. The goal of every Buddhist is to attain Buddhahood. Shantideva, a Buddhist teacher, says how one can attain Buddhahood. I quote from Shantideva: What need is there to say more? The childish work for their own benefit. The Buddhas work for the benefit of others. Just look at the difference between them. If I do not exchange my happiness for the sufferings of others, I shall not attain the state of Buddhahood. And even in samsara, I shall have no real joy. This is what Shantideva declares. There is a very interesting story in Buddhism. Asanga was one of the most famous Indian Buddhist saints who lived in the 4th century. He went to the mountains to do a solitary retreat, concentrating all his meditation practice on the Buddha Maitreya, in the fervent hope that he would be blessed with a vision of this Buddha and receive teachings from Buddha Maitreya. For 6 years, Asanga did penance but did not even have an auspicious dream, leave alone wisdom. He was disheartened and left his hermitage. On the way back home, he saw a man rubbing an enormous iron bar with a strip of silk. When Asanga asked him what he was doing, he said, "I am going to make a needle out of this iron bar with this silk cloth." Asanga was astounded by the trouble people were prepared to give themselves over things that are totally absurd. Therefore, he returned to his retreat. Another 3 years went by, still without the slightest sign of Buddha Maitreya. So Asanga got frustrated. He again came back. On the way, he saw a bend in the road where there was a huge rock. At the foot of the rock, there was a man who was busy rubbing it with a feather soaked in water. When asked about what he was doing, he said, "This rock is stopping the sun from shining on my house. Therefore, I am trying to get rid of this rock." Asanga was amazed at the man's indefatigable energy, and he was ashamed at his own lack of dedication. So he returned to his retreat. 3 more years passed, and still he had not even had a single good dream. He decided once and for all that it was hopeless. Therefore, he left his retreat for the good. On the way, Asanga saw a dog lying on the side of the road. It had only its front legs, and the whole of the lower part of the body was rotting and covered with maggots. Asanga was overwhelmed with a vivid and unbearable feeling of compassion. He cut a piece of flesh off his own body and gave it to the dog to eat. Then he bent down to take off the maggots that were consuming the dog's body. But he suddenly thought that he might hurt them if he tried to pull them from out of his fingers, with his fingers. And he realized that the only way to remove those maggots was to use his tongue. Asanga knelt on the ground, looking at the horrible, festering, writhing mass, closed his eyes. He leant closer and put out his tongue. The next thing he knew, his tongue was touching the ground. He opened his eyes and looked up. The dog was gone. There in its place was Buddha Maitreya, ringed by a shimmering aura of light. Asanga asked Maitreya as to why he did not show mercy on him for such a long time. Maitreya replied, "It is not correct to say that I never appeared before you. I was with you all the time, but your negative karma and obscurations prevented you from seeing me. Your 12 years of practice dissolved your karma slightly. 500 rupees you have collected." He said, "Your 12 years of practice dissolved your karma slightly so that you were at last able to see the dog. Then, thanks to your genuine and heartfelt compassion, All these obscurations were completely swept away, and you can see me before you with your own very eyes. If you don't believe that this is what has happened, put me on your shoulder and try and see if anyone else in the world can see me. Upon hearing these words, Asanga put Buddha Maitreya on his right shoulder and he went to the marketplace, where he began to ask everyone, "What have I got on my shoulder?" Most of the people said nothing. They hurried on. Only one woman, whose karma had been slightly purified, she answered, "Sir, you have got the rotting corpse of an old dog on your shoulder, that's all." Thus, Asanga understood the boundless power of compassion that purified and transformed his karma and made him a vessel fit to receive the vision and instruction of Maitreya. It is said that Buddha Maitreya then took Asanga to a heavenly realm and gave him many sublime teachings that are among the most important in the whole of Buddhism. While talking about compassion, we must understand that it is far greater and nobler than pity. Pity has its roots in fear and a sense of ignorance and condescension, sometimes even a smug feeling of, "I am glad it's not me." As Stephen Levin says, I quote, "When your fear touches someone's pain, it becomes pity. When your love touches someone's pain, it becomes compassion." To train in compassion, then, is to know all beings are the same and suffer in similar ways, to honor all those who suffer, and to know you are neither separate from nor superior to anyone. Mother Teresa said, I quote, "We all long for heaven where God is, but we have it in our power to be in the heaven with him at this very moment. But being happy with him now means loving as he loves, helping as he helps, giving as he gives, serving as he serves, rescuing as he rescues, being with him 24 hours, touching him in his distressing disguise." The Sanskrit equivalent of the word compassion is daya. The Shandilya Upanishad defines compassion or daya as daya nama sarva bhuteshu sarvatra anugraha. Daya means showing compassion to every object, every creature present everywhere. Since compassion is something that transcends kala, desa, vartamana, place, time, object and action, it is nothing but love that is universal in nature. We always identify heart as the organ that melts to the sufferings of others. The Sanskrit equivalent of the word heart is hridaya, which has as its root the word daya. The person who is good-hearted is identified as sahridaya. Therefore, a person who has no compassion is universally termed as heartless. Today, we are driven by a passion to be successful in life. But after succeeding, we realize that there is no fulfillment. Then we start making an introspection. I shall give you a real life example before I conclude. Some of the world's most successful financiers met in 1923 at the Edgewater Beach Hotel in Chicago. Present were the president of the largest independent steel company, president of the largest utility company, the greatest wheat speculator, the president of New York Stock Exchange, a member of the cabinet of the president of USA, the greatest bear on Wall Street, the president of the Bank of International Settlements, and the head of the world's greatest monopoly. These eight men together controlled more wealth than the US Treasury at that point of time. Success stories of these men had featured in magazines and journals for many years, but all of them had something in common towards the end of their lives. Charles Schwab, president of the steel company, lived the last years of his life on borrowed money and died a broken man. Arthur Cutten, the greatest speculator, died abroad insolvent. Richard Whitney, president of New York Stock Exchange, served a term in Sing Sing prison. Albert Fall, member of the president's cabinet, was pardoned from prison to die at home. Jesse Livermore, the greatest bear on Wall Street, Leon Fraser, president of the Bank of International Settlements, and Ivan Kruger, head of the world's largest monopoly, all committed suicide. Thus, 7 out of these 8 successful men ended their lives in tragedy and sorrow. So of what use their successful career? This is why Adi Shankara commanded all of us to ask a question to ourselves. Tatah kim, so what? Of what use my money? Of what use my Mercedes? Of what use my beach villa? Of what use my Swiss bank account? Leave alone of what use it is to me. Is it of any use to my own kith and kin? Because many of the people who hold large sums of money in Swiss banks don't even tell their wives. Therefore, all their life's earnings would go ultimately to the bank with whom they have never had any connection apart from holding an account. Therefore, Adi Shankara commands us to ask this question, Tatah kim, so what? I am the greatest man on earth, so what? I am the richest man on earth, so what? This is a question that we have to ask ourselves. Dear friends, I came across a poem whose author's name is not known. With due apologies to its author for infringing his copyright, let me quote that poem. Ready or not, someday it will all come to an end. There will be no more sunrises, no minutes, hours or days. All the things that you collected, whether treasured or forgotten, will pass on to someone else. Your wealth, fame, and temporal power will shrivel to irrelevance. It will not matter what you owned or what you were owed. Your grudges, resentments, frustrations, and jealousies will finally disappear. So too, your hopes, ambitions, plans, and to-do lists will expire. The wins and losses that once seemed so important will fade away. It won't matter where you came from or on what side of the tracks you lived at the end. It won't matter whether you were beautiful or brilliant. Even your gender and skin color will be irrelevant. So what will matter? How will the value of your days be measured? What will matter is not what you brought, what you bought, but what you built, nor what you got, but what you gave. What will matter is not your success, but your significance. What will matter is not what you learned, but what you taught. What will matter is every act of integrity, compassion, courage, or sacrifice that enriched, empowered, or encouraged others to emulate your example. What will matter is not your competence, but your character. What will matter is not how many people you knew, but how many will feel a lasting loss when you are gone. What will matter is not your memories, but the memories that live in those who loved you. What will matter is how long you will be remembered, by whom and for what. Even Hitler is remembered for a long time, but it matters who remembers you and for what they remember you. Living a life that matters does not happen by accident. It's not a matter of circumstance, but of choice. Choose to live a life that matters. We make a living by what we earn, but we make a life by what we give. Dear Theosophists, to summarize, passion, which is born out of emotion and which is an attribute of the mind, if channeled properly, can be converted into bhakti yoga. Dispassion or vairagya, if consecrated at the pita or foundation of all our activities, we may become karma yogis. But if we have eyes that well up with tears and a heart that melts at the sufferings of all creatures, living or the dead, animate or the inanimate, we might possibly have reached a state of Jnana Yoga. This is how I look at passion, dispassion and compassion. Thank you very much.